Welcome on this webinar on the hydraulic fill manual. The manual was published recently in December 2012 and is distributed already worldwide. My colleague Patrick Mengé is head of the geotechnical division of DEME.
My co-presenter Jan van 't Hoff is independent dredging consultant and he's one of the editors of the hydraulic fill manual.
The other editor, Mr. Adnoy van der Kolf, sadly enough passed away recently. The great contributions were made by authors and reviewers to realize this manual. From consultants, from contractors and from clients. The manual was also peer-reviewed by Syria in London, and we have had great support from them and great contributions to reach the quality of the manual as it is. At the end of this session, you will be able to formulate questions to us. It's about a quarter of an hour. And in the lower part of your screen, there is a block where you can put in your questions. And also in the lower part of your screen, you are able to enlarge the images so that you can see it better. We follow in this webinar the content of the hydraulic fill manual. That is the introduction and project initiation, data collection and selection of borrow area, dredging equipment, planning and construction, ground improvement, design of reclamation area, special fill material and problematic subsoils, and monitoring and quality control, and last but not least, specifications. And then a session follows with questions and answers. Hydraulic fill manual fills are widely used for projects such as airports, harbors, industrial and domestic areas. On the right image, you see the increase of volume used in fill areas from a couple of 10 million of cubic meters to over 500 million cubic meters. The objectives and the contents of the manual is to improve the understanding between the various parties involved in a hydraulic fill project. These are clients, contractors and consultants. The aim is also to present clear guidelines for initiation, design and construction of hydraulic fill projects and to provide a rational basis for technical specification of fill of reclamation projects. In this scheme, you see the development cycle of reclamation projects. There's of course the project definition. Is it an airport? Is it used for industrial as an industrial area or for domestic or in the domestic area? From this follows the functional requirements, from that performance requirements, and it all has to be worked out in the design of the project. Then, of course, the project has to be just on its feasibility. Is it technically feasible? Is it financially feasible? If it is not feasible, you may have to go back to redefining the functional requirement and go through the cycle again. Eventually, of course, it has to be constructed, but before that, the specifications have to be defined. Patrick?
Thank you. In order to be able to study a hydraulic fill project, one needs to gather data on several topics. In this chapter on data collection, the necessary data to be able to make a detailed study is summarized. In the next slide, we will go more into detail which data is required. But in the same chapter we discuss as well the amount of testing which is required, the reporting that should be realized, and some contractual aspects detailing who is responsible for the data and for the interpretation of the data depending on the type of contract. One should also realize that when we discuss the required data, this concerns both the reclamation area and the borrow area. To be able to select a correct or a good borrow area, one needs to know what material can be found there. So in a normal situation, one will start with the desk study, trying to gather information on possible borrow areas and on the reclamation area. A borrow area can be a dedicated borrow area, which is only selected because of the material which is found there, or it can be part of the dredging works, for example, the approach channel to a harbor or a turning circle. When doing a site investigation, the information required concerns several items. The first one in this slide is the bathymetric and topographical survey which is required. This can be on land by land survey, or as mostly is the case, over water by single beam sonar or by multi-beam sonar. Secondly, we need information on geological and geotechnical situation at the site. This can be realized by geophysical methods, which are often used in offshore soil investigation because of the large areas which need to be covered. Refraction seismic are most often used, but also geoelectric surveys are used from time to time. When doing boreholes, information is retrieved from the soil type that is encountered, and boreholes are combined with sampling, disturbed sampling and undisturbed sampling for further laboratory testing. Different borehole techniques exist, or different techniques for sampling exist. Next slide will show them more in detail. Testing in the lab is classification testing and triaxial testing for strength, or compression testing for compressibility, or deformation testing of the material. Finally, also in situ testing can be realized by cone penetration testing, which is a preferable technique, but also by SPT testing. Hydraulic, morphological and meteorological data is environmental data needed in the borrow area, in the reclamation area, to be able to assess, for example, the workability of your equipment, or to design the revetments of the side slopes of land reclamation projects. And a whole series of information needs to be gathered. Finally, seabed obstructions need to be known before one starts to dredge, and this can be unexploded ordnance or wrecks or boulders, or pipelines, whatever is present on the sea bottom. And this can be investigated by side scan sonar, multi-beam or magnetometers. On this slide you see different equipment that can be used for site investigation or soil investigation. At the left side you see equipment, the high-end equipment, for example a jack-up platform which can be used for drilling and CPT testing, or a vessel, a drilling vessel, which can be used in very deep waters. All the other equipment, like the bottom core, vibro core, drop core, is all equipment that is used for sampling the sea bottom up to limited depth. For example, a vibro core can go up to 8 meters, but it's rather limited for deeper explorations, boreholes from jack-up platforms or from soil investigation vessels is required. When selecting a borrow area, it is very important to make sure that the correct material, the suitable material as it is very often called, is present. Suitable material in general is considered granular material with a limited number of fines. To be able to assess this, we need soil investigation, but in a sufficient quantity, because we need to be able to predict how much material is available in a borrow area and which are the material characteristics. By laboratory testing, one can define the shear strength. But dredging will also create a change or cause a change in the particle size distribution of the material. So we also need to be able to assess how much this change will be and what will be the material characteristics after dredging. In order to be able to assess the quantity of the fill material, it is important to have sufficient boreholes or CPT tests so that a 3D soil model, geological model, can be made and can be used for calculation of volumes. Further on, also the dredgeability of the material, stability of the borrow area, of the side slopes, for example, of the dredging, needs to be assessed. In some cases, we do not use granular material as suitable material, but alternative fill materials can be used because they originate from dredging and need to be reused. This can be clay material, and also a good assessment of the quality of this material to be able to predict how it will behave in the reclamation area is important. Jan?
Important also for the realization of a fill area is, of course, dredging equipment. Now, this scheme shows the conditions on which dredging equipment can be selected. And I cannot go in detail to all these conditions, but it varies from the location of the borrow area to the required dredging productions. And equipment can be mechanical dredging equipment or suction dredging equipment. Once this is selected, the dredging method can be established from borrow area, transport of the fill material to the fill area. And ultimately, of course, costs have to be established. Now, as you can see from this scheme, cost cannot be established straight. There is not such a thing as cost for dredging like 4 euros per cubic meters or so. It depends very much on all sorts of conditions. It depends on the transport distance from the borrow area to the fill area. It depends on the soil conditions. It depends how the fill has to be placed. As I said, the types of dredges can be distinguished in suction dredging and mechanical dredging. In the manual, we discuss plain suction dredging for suction dredging, cutter suction dredging, and trailing suction hopper dredges. For mechanical cutting, for mechanical dredging, backhoe dredges are discussed, grab dredges, and the use of a bucket dredge. For a detailed description again, I refer to the manual, and the information is very useful for planners and designers of a fill area. Here you see the plain suction dredge and the way it operates. It operates in a borrow pit, the dedicated borrow pit. It is specialized in dredging sandy material and can either load material in barges alongside or transport material through pipelines to shore. The cutter suction dredge is more widely used than the plain suction dredge. It has a wide range of applications, and production can vary to a couple of 100 meters, cubic meters per hour, to 2,500 or even 3,000 cubic meters per hour, depending on the size of the dredge, or even more. Then there is the trailing suction hopper dredge. It's a very versatile dredge, also widely used. It is a self-propelled dredge, so it is not stationary like the other ones, so it is less vulnerable to in its operation by passing ships. On the slides you see how the hopper is filled and what ways there are to discharge the material. It can be either through the bottom door, through a pipeline, or by rainbowing. This slide show you the mechanical dredges. Again, they are discussed in the manual, so for detailed description I refer to the manual. It's the grab dredger, the backhoe dredger, and the bucket dredger. In this slide you see possible dredging chains for dredging the material in the borrow area, transporting it and placing it. This slide shows you the use of suction dredges. The following slide shows you the use and possible combination using mechanical dredges. Planning and construction methods. Well, for the fill area, it's important to know how much material is required in the fill area and the target dates. That determines the required dredging production. The depth of the fill area, the base of the fill area, is important. Whether you can place material by submerged placement through dumping, rainbowing, or spraying, and placing above water, either by rainbowing or by pipeline transport. Also important is the size and the thickness of the above water fill area. That determines the layout of the discharge pipeline, the layout of the drainage channels, and the sand key configurations. And then, of course, you have to get rid of the process water. So how is this discharged? And possibly you have to protect the wave, the fill area against flood and waves. This slide shows you various ways in which dredged material can be placed in the fill area, either by dumping using a trailing suction hopper dredge, set as bulk placement, or by making keys first, by which placing in a controlled manner is possible. Of course, these keys don't have to be made of sand, but can also be rock fill keys. And then key construction above water using bulldozers. And in soft material, the keys penetrate through the soft material, making a fixed foundation for the enclosed fill area. Fill properties change during placing. On the reclamation area, the relative density is determined by the way material is placed. Bulking will occur. Bulking is the difference in volume between the situ volume and the fill volume. For soft material, this can be much higher, this can be a factor 2. For sand, it can be, for instance, 20% or so. So in determining your production capacity and in determining the volume of the fill area, you need to know the bulking. Then segregation of fines can occur. They can be deliberately or they can be accidentally, but segregation of fines occurs through overflowing or through the management of the fill area by making siltation ponds. Patrick?
Once the fill area is realized, the reclamation area is realized, there might be a need of ground improvement. This, of course, depends on the design and the requirements originating from the functional design of the reclamation area. For example, deformations, bearing capacity, stability or liquefaction may be drivers to come to a soil improvement technique. One needs to look both at the fill material and at the subsoil. The technique, the choice of a certain technique, will also be influenced by the type of soil. Being granular material or being cohesive material will lead to completely different techniques to be used. And the choice made for a certain ground improvement technique may influence the dredging, the execution method of the whole reclamation project. For example, when a soft subsoil exists in the reclamation area, one may choose for replacing it by granular material, or one may choose for filling the material on top of the soft soil and improving the soft soil by, for example, surcharging. So the choice for one or another technique in the design stage of the project is very important and can lead to different results. In the manual, a table is given with techniques which are very often used in dredging, and we will not discuss them in detail because of limited time available, but mainly the soil type in which they are applicable and the depth to which they have influence is a very important driver for the choice for one or another technique. In this slide you see different techniques. For example, the left top picture shows the installation of vertical drains, which is a technique for accelerating the consolidation of the soil, which is caused, of course, the consolidation process is caused by the fill, the weight of the fill that is realized, or even the weight of the fill plus a surcharge that is realized. It's a technique often used to improve soft subsoil under reclamation to guarantee limited settlements after final construction. Right from the vertical drains you see a technique, the rapid impact compaction technique. It's recently used a lot the last few years in dredging projects and reclamation projects, because it's a typical technique which allows you to compact layers of 4 to 6 meter thickness. One should realize that in hydraulic fill we realize layers of thickness of 2 to 3 meter. So compaction techniques working on layers of 30 centimeter, like is often used in earthworks, is not a possible technique in hydraulic fill works. At the bottom you see left the high energy impact compaction. It's also a dynamic compaction technique which has a depth of influence of about 2 meters. Right from that picture you see the well-known dynamic compaction technique, or heavy tamping, in which a weight is dropped from a certain height and a depth of influence of 10 to 12 meters can be reached. And then totally right on the pictures you see a vibroflot, which is the most used technique for deep compaction of granular fill material with a limited amount of fines. And by vibrating this probe into the ground, depths up to 20 or even 30 meters can be reached and can be compacted. The second, the next chapter is the chapter on design of a reclamation area. And of course, design is fully linked to the requirements of the project, of the functional requirements of the projects, and lead to technical specifications which will be written into the contract between engineer and contractor. It's important to be able to make a design before execution, and in hydraulic fills works it's a bit difficult because the area still needs to be realized. So the quality of the material is unknown and needs to be assessed. Therefore we need a lot of investigation into the borrow area, as discussed earlier. Different aspects will be specified or need to be studied, and one of the main aspects is the density the fill will have. As already discussed in the chapter on compaction, one may need to change the density of the material from how it was put after a hydraulic fill and what it needs to be in final situation. On the table shown in this slide you see different ranges of density which can be achieved by hydraulic fill underwater or above water by different techniques like discharging, by spraying, by dumping, by rainbowing, and so on. Each has a certain range of density to be expected. In design, when going to strength and stiffness, all these parameters are related to density at one side, but also to stress level at the other side. So density certainly is an important issue and is often used in the specifications to guarantee a certain behavior. Different aspects can be, or different definitions can be used. For example, degree of compaction, degree percentage of the maximum dry density which can be achieved, but also relative density or relative void ratio. In the hydraulic fill manual, all these definitions are clearly discussed because very often there is misunderstanding in the use of these parameters. Finally, one can question whether the use of relative density in geotechnics is a correct approach, because very often differences occur in relative density depending on the methods used to define minimum and maximum density, or on the correlation used to link in-situ tests with relative density, and for example material grading, material mineralogy can have an influence on that. With regard to strength, one thinks about effective strength, effective shear strength parameters, or undrained shear strength of cohesive material. How to predict these parameters when a hydraulic fill still has to be realized? As said, a lot of testing in the borrow area is necessary to define combined with laboratory testing, for example, at different relative densities, or with cohesive soil, one needs to define the peak and residual shear strength and then assess how it will behave in the reclamation area. Strength is needed to study, for example, bearing capacity, punch through when a soft layer exists, squeezing, and slope stability. Another important parameter is stiffness, used to assess the formation of the reclamation area. Stiffness is an even more difficult parameter to define, because stiffness is very much strain and stress dependent. So defining a certain stiffness in the specifications is very difficult, and it is advised to go more to behavior specification. How does it need to behave, the reclamation, and which are the allowable settlements that can be tested by, for example, a zone load test. When defining allowable settlements, one needs to define whether it is primary settlements or secondary settlements or a combination of both. Sometimes differential settlements are also a requirement, but to be able to study this, one needs a lot of site investigation to assess the possible differential settlements. Finally, in designing a reclamation area, liquefaction is a very important issue when working with granular material. In literature, a lot of documentation exists on liquefaction, and in this hydraulic fills manual, only a limited part of this huge topic is discussed. There exist, for example, empirical methods to assess liquefaction. These are not discussed in detail in the manual, because there exist many different methods and many different authors have different approaches. But it is shown how it can be approached, this problem. And it's very important that in specifications it's clearly defined how liquefaction needs to be assessed and which are the boundary conditions. Jan, please.
As Patrice said already, fill material is not always nice sand with very little fine content. It can also be clayey sand, clayey material. or cabinet sand, which is extensively used in the Far East, or even rock fill. Clay, the handling of clay, is very much determined by the plasticity index of the material. So when transporting and dressing and placing clay, clay balls may occur, which are, require extra pumping capacity and extra measures on the reclamation area for placement and handling. When mechanically dredging, clay lumps, the clay lumps will show very little bulking, and that's why mechanical excavation is usually preferably used for placing, for dredging and placing the clay. The, as I said already, the mechanical dredging causes minor changes in water content and therefore also minor changes in the volume. But when dredging it hydraulically, significant bulking may occur with water content 2 times the liquid limit. Extra consolidation time is required. Also, large storage areas are required. But the material will distribute more homogeneously than when mechanically dredged. Clay having a content more than 5 to 10% should not be used for fill purposes. Clay is workable having a consistency index between 0.6 and 0.1. This can be created by ripening of the clay, adding additives, adding surcharges to get rid of the pore water. Clay can be extra, say when providing a sandwich structure, clay can be placed in the fill area in a controlled manner. Consolidation can be accelerated using vacuum consolidation. Another possibility, another material, as I've said already, is the use of carbonate sands. Well, carbonate sands have specific, very specific properties and differ from siliceous sands. They are crushable, they are cemented, they have a lower density than sand, they are more compressible. The loading causes more high peak stress, they have more high peak shear strengths, but the lower CPT and SPT values at same compaction level. When doing your laboratory test and field test, you should take that into account. Also, specifications should allow for the differences between sand and carbonate sand. Then rock, not the ideal material to create fill, to make a fill area, but sometimes there is no other choice. The lump size for cutter suction dredges should not exceed 30 to 50 centimeters, but then you need quite a large dredge also. When using a backhoe dredge, the rock is blasted before, and the blasting pattern should be such that the lump sizes can be handled by the backhoe dredge. When specifying the rock fill area, one should try to avoid specification of maximum lump size these specifications should only apply to the top layer, but in the lower layer, rock lumps should be allowed. The grading is difficult to control. The strength by which rocks can be dredged is more or less 60 megapascal, but again, you need a very large, powerful dredge to do that. Density in situ is difficult to measure, and the wear of tear, which are caused by the rock to the dredge, is extensive, of course. In the manual, special attention is paid to sensitive clay, to peat, to glacial soils, to sapka, to karst and laterite. And I refer you to the manual to read more about this. Patrick?
Thank you. In the chapter on monitoring and quality control, different techniques are discussed which can be used for monitoring. Of course, what needs to be measured depends on the specifications and depends on the level the specifications have been made. For example, one can work with performance requirements, which is bearing capacity. Linked to bearing capacity, a certain strength can be required. One can check the strength. Residual sediments are linked to stiffness. Resistance against liquefaction can be linked to density. Drainage characteristics can be linked to permeability. So depending on the requirements, certain parameters of the material or the mass behavior needs to be verified. Different approaches are possible, and one can go from material testing, which is very detailed testing, looking at individual samples and doing a lot of laboratory testing, CPT testing. One can also go to behavior monitoring, checking settlements and behavior of the reclamation area. Performance testing is another level, in which one checks for bearing capacity with plate load tests or zone load tests. Process monitoring is also a level of monitoring which is can be suggested and is following a certain working method and check whether the exact procedure is always followed. In the manual, a table is given with an example of possible testing frequencies, and I'm not going to discuss this table in detail, it's too small. But anyhow, one should realize that in dredging projects, in land reclamation projects, very large volumes of material occur and very large surfaces occur. And when a lot of detailed testing is required, there will be an important cost related to that, but more, it will also influence much on the planning, because the testing can only be, many of the testing can only be done at the end of the project, and in when, for example, CPT testing is required at 25 meter boxes, it may require a lot of testing and may require different CPT apparatus. Finally, the last but not least chapter is on specifications. One of the reasons of writing the hydraulic fill manual is to come to hydraulic fill projects in which specifications are sufficiently into detail to avoid many discussions in execution. However, in this manual we were not able to give standard specifications because projects can be very different from one to another. When drafting specifications, the logic in the manual can be followed. The table of contents of the manual, in fact, goes through the different items which need to be specified. And the level of detail to be given in specifications depend, of course, on the type of contract, as we will discuss in the next slide in which a flow chart is given. In the manual, you will also find a table with checklist and comments on different issues. Some examples are also discussed in the manual, in which have examples which have led to discussion in interpretation because they were not specific enough or because they were double up with other specifications, and a lot of these examples can be used to come to more correct specifications. So the specifications should avoid confusion during tender and construction phase. Technical specifications need to be in line with the responsibilities as defined by the contract. And technical specifications shall be clear, shall in clear terms define, describe the design and the construction and monitoring activities. which the contractor is required to make. These last two points on the slide are sentences copied from the manual and trying to help in defining the correct specifications. So in this chart you see that from a certain project one will define functional requirements. From the functional requirements one can derive performance requirements and finally technical specifications. This flowchart, and there is a second flowchart which is not on the slides but you can see it in the book, also takes into account the type of contract. Is it design and construct contract, then typically only the functional requirements need to be defined and it is up to the designer to define which are the technical specifications to guarantee that the functional requirements or the performance requirements can be achieved. This is what is shown in this flowchart. Finally, in this checklist shown in the hydraulic fill manual, only the two top lines are copied here on the chapter on data collection and the chapter on dredging equipment. And as you can see, different functional requirements and performance requirements following from these functional requirements are discussed with the technical specifications that can result from that, with some remarks about whether or not they are achievable, in which situation they are achievable, and so on. Jan.
Well, thank you, Patrick. Well, this was the end of our presentation, and there is now time for questions. We just received a question on what slopes are formed by hydraulic fill, depending on the placement the fill is placed, the sand fill is placed.
I will.
Can you answer that, Charlotte? It's well, it is in our presentation. We have this table, so probably you can show that.
So, in hydraulic fill, different slopes are realized underwater and above water.
Somewhere in the beginning, yeah.
I'm going back to the correct slide now.
Yeah. Before that. There.
So, different slopes can be realized depending on the fill above water and below water. Because above water the energy of the hydraulic, the flow in which the sand particles have to deposit, the slope above water will be very gentle. Underwater, where the energy has been broken, the slopes will be more steep. But on top of that, the slope also depends on the particle characteristics of the material used. And very often it's defined in function of the D50, so the mean grain size of the sand used. And in the table at the bottom of this slide, you see orders of magnitude of slopes for certain grain sizes, which will be formed above water and below water in calm sea areas or in rough sea areas. So for example, a 200 micron sand material may form a slope of 1 on 25 above the water table, while below the water table it will vary between 1 on 5 or 1 on 10. So this is an effect of hydraulic fill, which can be used also when a fill on very soft soils needs to be realized. You can make very gentle slopes, and when you are above the water table, you can make very gentle slopes, thus giving you a technique to realize a fill on top of very soft soil, for example.
Well, thank you, Patrick. And there just came in another question about what relative density will occur depending on the way sand is placed. I think you dealt with that, yeah. There it is.
So in this table, at the top right corner of the slide, you see different techniques shown. So the saturated soil means, in general, underwater. So by spraying, you get between 20 and 40%. By dumping, 30 to 50%. So it all depends on the technique used. Rainbowing will give a higher density because of the impact effects. Above the soil, above the water table, dry soil will give higher densities when, for example, in discharge area by hydraulic fill and then the bulldozers driving to dewater it, 50 to 60% can be reached. But as a comparison, when dry earth movement is realized, and that's with the dump truck, then the density can be very low, can be only 20% relative density. And of course, with compaction, high energy used, like in earthworks, in thin layers, one can reach up to 100% relative density. A remark that can be given is density, which is achievable underwater by deep compaction techniques, is limited to about 70% relative density. One cannot achieve 100% relative density with deep compaction, for example, or very high energy input is required. Okay.
Well, thanks again, Patrick. And there is an additional question, how to handle clay soft material in the fill area. The term sandwich structure was used. Can you explain that?
When using soft material as fill material, one has to consider different approaches. And in general, because hydraulic dredging with a cutter or with a hopper mixes up the material and adds a lot of water to it, it is preferable to do mechanical dredging when soft material needs to be reused. Otherwise, you get a slurry with a very low density, which is difficult to use. So in mechanical dredging, barges are filled and they sail to the reclamation area and the material is dumped underwater in layer thicknesses of 2 or 3 meters. In order to promote the consolidation, horizontal layers of sand sometimes are realized in between the clay layers, thickness 1 to 2 meters, also by dumping or pumping material on top of the dredged material, soft material which is placed in the area. This is meant with a sandwich structure. It's used in the past several in several projects in Singapore, and leads to a result which of course gives more deformations compared to a full sand fill, but with surcharging and other soil improvement techniques, it can lead to a solution with limited deformations. Was that an answer to the question, Jan?
Well, I think extensive answer, thank you. Some more questions came in. I have a question here from Wouter Roebeek, a graduate student from Delft University. His question is about fill losses during beach nourishment, sand on sand. What do you see as the main factors that cause losses, and what is the most significant one? So that is a question which really refers to dredging experience,
yes.
Beach nourishment. Losses during beach nourishment. What do you see as the main factors that cause losses, and what is the most significant one? It looks like a puzzle.
Well, I think you are pumping material in an open reclamation area, as we call it. It's beach nourishment. So
into nature.
You can have losses due to fines which remain in suspension and drop down out of your reclamation area. I think this is certainly one of the causes of loss. But of course, the main is the effect of waves and material which is displaced during your filling process into the beach. Well, depends what you consider to be the beach and to consider to be the reclamation area. Of course, a beach is a dynamic it's a dynamic structure in which material is placed, is displaced depending on the wave attack and so on. So some material will move to a lower part of the slope underwater. But the question is, do you want this or do you do not want this? It's all part of the design of the beach. Putting material above water is making a choice for material, for a certain buffer of material that will be displaced anyhow. So I'm a bit afraid that the example of beach nourishment is a difficult question to answer on, because you know that material will be displaced once wave attack occurs. So is this loss or is this a result which is expected? So maybe my answer to the question is not exactly what was focused by the one asking the question, Jan, but I think it's a special situation here which is has not one single answer.
Well, but thank you very much again for your answer. And I think we have to move on quickly to another answer, to another question, because of time is limited. Is there a standard guide on estimating the percentage of spill discharged from different dredger while loading or overflow? Loss from propeller wash, as well loss of spill from disposal activity. Question is basically, is there a standard guide to that on estimating the percentage of spill? It's quite a wide question, isn't it?
Yes.
What dredge do you mean? But if you focus then probably on the trailing suction hopper dredge, then there is overflow. So
this is the question, while loading or overflow?
Yeah, okay. So trailing suction hopper dredge. And loss from propeller wash, well, that's the impacts on the seabed. You know, if the seabed is close enough to the propeller. And loss of spill from disposal activities, that's from the fill area.
I think we can answer only the first part of the question, because that's the clear one. Yeah. And the loss of material in overflow depends on the particle size distribution of the material itself. So that's why we need soil investigation in the reclamation area. You know how many fines material are present in the sand.
Yeah.
And then it can be estimated how much will disappear. It will not be a sharp difference, everything smaller than 63 micron disappears. That's not correct. Of course, some material gets caught in the sand mass, but in general it's the finer particles which will disappear in overflow, unless a special dredging technique or a hopper filling technique is used where no overflow is allowed. But then you can avoid loss, but your hopper is sailing with a very limited load. It's almost sailing with water at that moment. So the question is not fully to the point, in fact, but when overflow is allowed, you can estimate that most of the particles, let's say 80% of the particles finer than 63 micron, will get lost maybe also a bit coarser particles will get lost, certainly at the end of filling the hopper, but that is neglectable.
Yeah. There's not such a thing as a standard guide.
No.
Another question. Will the brochure of the webinar be published? That's one question. The other one, yes, it will be. So it will become available in a couple of days, and then you will get the webinar available on the IADC website. Second question is, if very high requirements by client design and to final leveling of underwater fill surface, any technique please? From Averbuk, Ukraine. If very high requirements by client design and to final leveling of any technique please? Okay, so in case you need very tight tolerances on what you create below water, it can be for instance a foundation for a trench, for a breakwater construction, in case of breakwater construction or so, say then what are then the most tightly requirements which you can realize by dredging equipment? I think that's the question.
Yes.
So.
Okay, maybe. Question one is, why do you need a very high requirement? So I think we always need to look at a problem from different sides. It's for example, the foundation with rock material under a gravity-based caisson. Sometimes one requires plus minus 5 centimeters to the level which is required. Is this reasonable if you have to realize this with rock which has size of, for example, 10 centimeters? So first of all, is the requirement which one puts forward, is it a reasonable requirement? Is it a necessary requirement? When you put a gravity-based foundation on a rock base, the individual stones will still displace itself. So now I will try to give an answer to your question more directly. What is achievable underwater? It depends also in which circumstances, which is the wave climate one has to work in, which is the depth one has to work in. But sometimes techniques with, for example, a foul pipe with a remote operated vehicle are used to iron the surface of a material placed underwater. It's a job which is not easily done, but it can be realized, and quite high levels of precision can be achieved. Plus minus 30 centimeter, I would say, is very acceptable requirement. When one goes to plus minus 5 centimeter, it's a very high requirement which is difficult to achieve, but as I may say, also difficult to check underwater.
Yeah. Well, in my experience, I've dealt with a situation that very tight requirements were had to be achieved by dredging, but on that bed, rock had to be placed, which was the foundation of a caisson breakwater. Now it was indeed not reasonable to define very tight requirements for the sand bed, because the rock bed on top of the sand bed that had to adhere to these to tight tolerances, so the sand bed should not have been that tight. And that in my case, the sand bed was required at 10 centimeters. So you have to look at the engineering benefits of defining very tight tolerances. Well, I think there's time for one more question. Let's see if there is another question. There's one from Bart van der Schriek. what is the best way to measure the permeability in situ in order to determine the pit production of a sandborrow pit using the breaching process. So that's plain suction dredging and the behaving of a borrow pit due to breaching. I think this is a very special subject. That's why I left the question for the last one. Well, question first is, do you need this permeability to know? You need to know whether it breaches, yes or no.
Yeah.
And, well, often relative density is used for that. And the grain size distribution, whether it has a breaching nature, yes or no.
Well, in theory, the permeability has an influence on how fast the breach moves forward. But when the question is how to measure permeability, it's pure soil mechanical testing. It's you can do lab tests or you can do in situ testing, which is always more reliable for dewatering projects. But whether it's reliable for predicting the behavior of a breaching process in which thin layers will have an influence, that's a much more difficult question. So I agree, Jan, it's a very it's a difficult one, and you can define permeability, but I'm not sure it will help you completely in predicting the breaching behavior in situ.
Well, I think we have now reached the end of this webinar, and I thank you all for your attention. And thanks again to IADC, International Association of Dredging Companies, which facilitated this session. And thank you very much for your contribution in providing the questions. Thank you very much.